So now we're going to look at some of the terminology and how we study how specific genes and specific alleles get passed down from one individual to the next. So a gene is a specific section of DNA that codes for a protein. So you saw this when we did protein synthesis. We take one gene and we turn it into RNA, messenger RNA, and then it gets turned into a protein and then that gets expressed. So an allele is a different form of a gene. So in our example here, we've got the cleft chin, which the cleft chin's got that little indent in it, and then the uncleft chin where there's no indent there. So this is a genetically determined trait. And so that physical expression is made by the proteins that develop and form that structure. And the genetic component that determines whether you have a cleft chin or not is the alleles. And there are two different forms of alleles in this particular example. We have big C, which is going to be the dominant allele, and we have little c, which is recessive. So what this means is dominant is going to cover up the recessive allele. In order for the recessive trait to show through, you can't have a dominant trait there. So each person has two spots for each gene, right? We have two copies of each gene, one from our mom and one from our dad. So we're going to get one allele from mom and one allele from dad, which means that we have three different combinations of these two alleles that we can have to express this trait. Those are homozygous dominant, homozygous recessive, and heterozygous. So homozygous dominant. This prefix here, homo, this is a word we're going to see a lot. This means same. And for this one, we're talking about it's got the same letter. It's either both big C or both little c. They're the same. And dominant tells us we're talking about big C. So if somebody is homozygous dominant, then they have big C, big C. And this is called their genotype. This is the genotype is what is in the alleles, the genes. So somebody who's homozygous dominant for both of these traits, or sorry, for both of these alleles, has a dominant C and a dominant C. Well, we know that cleft chin is dominant, so this person is going to have a cleft chin. Having a cleft chin is what we call the phenotype, or the physical expression. So the genotype is the genetics, and the phenotype is what you physically see. All right, our next possibility is homo, so they're going to be the same. Homozygous, recessive. So this time, instead of having two capital C's, we're going to have two little c's. The genotype is little c, little c. And the phenotype, are they going to have a cleft chin or an uncleft chin? They should have an uncleft chin, so no cleft chin here. And then the last possibility is that they have one of each, a big C and a little c. And it doesn't actually matter which one we write first, but for semantics, we always write big C, little c, capital letters first. This prefix here, hetero, means different. Okay, so that's different alleles, and we don't need a recessive or dominant because they have one of each, one dominant and one recessive. So are they going to have a cleft chin or no cleft chin if they're heterozygous? Well, the dominant allele completely covers up the recessive allele. So if there's even one dominant big C, they're going to end up with the dominant trait, which is, in this case, the cleft chin. So we often show these inheritance patterns through something called a Punnett square. And you can see an example here. So if we're going to take an individual who is big C, little c, cross them with somebody who's big C, little c. So these individuals both have a cleft chin, and they are both heterozygous for the trait. Well, let's think about how genes actually get passed down. Let's say one of these is a woman, one of these is a man, and they're going to have a child. Well, when they pass down their traits, the woman is going to have eggs, and her eggs are either going to have a big C or a little c. And when we make eggs, you only get one or the other. You don't pass both into each egg. And then the man is going to use sperm. Right, there's a sperm with a big C or a little c. Those are the gametes. So when we draw a Punnett square, the gametes go on the top and on the side. And it doesn't matter which place you put the woman or the man. So the woman over here, she's got one gamete here, big C, one gamete there, little c. Put the man on the top, one gamete here, big C, one gamete there, little c. So what we do is we drag these across to the side and down to line them up in each of these boxes. So this box is going to have a big C, big C. The next box is going to have a big C from the left and a little c from the top. This one's got a big C from the top and a little c from the left, but I'm going to write the big C first because that's how we write them. And then this last box is going to be little c, little c. So these are all of the possible offspring. So each box is a potential baby that this couple can have. And this is just showing us the probabilities. So if this chance, if this couple had a baby, they have a 1 in 4 chance of having big C, big C. So that's 25%. There's two of these. They have a 2 out of 4, which reduces to 1/2, chance of having big C, little c. That's 50%. And then they have a 1 out of 4 chance of having little c. So again, 25%. So this is our homozygous dominant, heterozygous, homozygous recessive. These two are both going to have a cleft chin. So we can add that up and say that it's 75% chance that they're going to have a cleft chin baby. This one is the recessive trait, so this is no cleft chin. So we have a 25% chance of having a baby with no cleft chin from these two parents. Let's look at a couple of different patterns of inheritance. One that's of interest to anatomy is talking about human blood groups. So when we have human blood groups, there's actually three different alleles. So there's multiple alleles. You can pass down the allele for type A blood, type B blood, or O blood. So that means we're going to end up with more than just our typical two different possibilities. You can be AA or AO, and those will be both type A. You can be BB or BO, and those will both be type B. Again, this is the genotype, and this is the phenotype. Your genotype can be AB, which gives you type AB, and your genotype can be OO, which gives type O. The reason there's two up here is because A and B are both dominant alleles, and O is a recessive allele. So when A and O are together, the dominant A covers up the O, and you get type A. When B and O are together, the dominant allele covers up the O, and you get type B. But we have something interesting happening with the type AB blood. They're called co-dominant. This prefix co, think of the word like cooperate, co-worker. Co means together or with. These are both dominant, so what happens is they are actually both expressed equally. And we can see this down here. So this is somebody with type A blood, and they have these little circle spikes on their red blood cells, which are the type A antigen. And then this is somebody who's type B, so this is AA or AO. Somebody who's type B will be BB or BO. And the type B antigens are these diamonds instead of circles. That's the physical difference. But somebody who's type AB is actually going to express both. They have circles from their A allele, and they have diamonds from their B allele. And then somebody who's type O, they actually don't have any antigens on their blood cells, which is what makes them the universal donor. So type B O blood can give to any other groups. Type A, because they have both, are the universal recipient. And so somebody who has type A blood can actually receive blood from anybody else. Sometimes we'll talk about traits that are specifically on the X or the Y chromosome. This will come in handy when we start talking in anatomy too about like development and sexual reproduction. So if you look at this, the X chromosome is really big, right? There's this big red chromosome here is the X chromosome. The Y chromosome is really small. So overwhelmingly, there are more genes on the X chromosome than the Y chromosome. So we tend to get X-linked traits that are much more common than Y-linked traits. The Y chromosome mostly has genes for maleness that kick in at the beginning of the development to tell the fetus to go ahead and become male, and then again later at puberty. The X chromosome has a lot of different genes on it. So some common X-linked disorders are red-green colorblindness and hemophilia. Hemophilia is a bleeding disorder, and so somebody with hemophilia does not clot well, and so they can be more apt to bleed out from cuts or internal damage. So down here, we're showing somebody who is, we're looking at the trait for colorblindness. So in this case, big C is dominant, and this is gonna stand for normal vision. And our little c is going to be colorblind. A sex-linked trait is more common in males. And the reason it's more common in males is because they only have one chromosome with that trait on it. The Y chromosome does not carry the X-linked C, right? They only have one C. Here's a female. So a female is XX. Those are the sex chromosomes of a female. This female is heterozygous. So they have big C, little c. So is this person normal or colorblind? She's going to have normal vision because this dominant allele is going to completely mask this recessive allele. She's something called a carrier. So she's normal, but she could pass it on to the next generation. So that's what a carrier is. A carrier is somebody who's heterozygous for a trait, which meaning they don't show the disease or they have a normal disposition, but they have the potential to pass that disorder onto the next generation. Here's a male. He's only got one little c. He doesn't have another X chromosome to cover it up. So because he's only got one little c, it's kind of a 50-50 chance. Does he have it or is he colorblind? So this male is going to be colorblind. So if you know anybody who's red-green colorblind, they're probably male. It's very unlikely for a female to be red-green colorblind because they would need to have two little c's instead of just one. So take a moment and go ahead and practice doing a Punnett square.